Hi, and welcome to the second episode of Building My Ultimate Workbench. My name is Dennis, and I am from Hooked on Wood. For those who have not seen episode 1, I hope you watch it after you watch this one. I think it's really worth it. I want to thank everyone for the comments on episode 1. It really made all the efforts I put into this video worth it. I will continue this video with a voiceover, but I hope you enjoy this part as much as I did with making it. Thank you for watching. And enjoy this part of building my ultimate workbench. In episode 1, I showed you why this is my ultimate workbench. And I showed you how I built the workbench step by step. On my website www.hookedonwood.online, you can find free plans, and together with this video, everyone should be able to build this workbench. In this episode, I will show you how I add the router, build my dust extraction box, and create a removable fence system without compromises. And at the end, I want to tell a few things that I forgot in episode 1. The workbench is ready at this moment, but we also want to use it as a router table, so we have to add the router. I choose this moment to add the router because you can already use the dog holes and you can easily cut through your table. First, we have to measure how deep we have to cut to level the router plate with your workbench top. It should be a little bit deeper than the thickness of your plate because we have to be able to adjust the insert. Now we transfer the measurement to the router. I add a block at the router to make it more stable when using it with my template. Now it's just easy to follow the curves of your template. Here I made a mistake that I did not fully plunge my router, and because of this, the bearing wheel went over the template and cut inside the template. After finishing the job, I could look at the damage I create. To fix it, I sent some material from the top surface, mixed it with some glue, and used it to fill the holes. In the end, it's a shame it happened, but I'm pretty satisfied with the way I could fix it. Now I use my jigsaw to remove the material in between, and I use my dog holes and a straight edge to guide my jigsaw. So this is how I add the router with a template. I used a CNC cut template and I bought this one. But you can also make it yourself. And afterwards I have to say that here's a clip from my former workbench, where I made the template myself, and I found the results the same. So I will show you how you can easily make it yourself. To make the tabletop around the router stronger, I added another 90mm MDF board at the underside. The way I made this hole in the middle is precisely the way you can make a template. I measured the distance between the side of the bit and the edge of the router plate. You add this number twice to the dimension of your router insert. Here I show you why you have to add this number twice in all directions. With some pocket holes, I made a frame with these exact measurements. Now we can use our router platform as a guide to follow the frame. We can do this with just a straight bit. After a few passes, we get ourselves a template we can use as I showed you before. Another method to make the hole for your router top plate is how I made this hole. And that is the way I milled the gap on my last workbench, by laying down the frame directly on the workbench. I do not think there is a good or bad to these methods. I think the use of a template is a little bit more secure and you can store it for perhaps future use. A big advantage of my workbench is that I can attach the fence in under 20 seconds. For this, we have to make a platform that we can connect to the workbench top. On this platform, we add the fence. I made this base with a curve, but there's no reason to do this. I just liked it. I drew this curve on a thin MDF piece I use as a template. By flipping it around, I have it nicely mirrored. With the bandsaw, I saw it roughly and I finish it with my router table. To make the fence removable, I use the dog holes. So I use my UJK system again to add two holes. And by using this method, I know that these two holes are on the exact same spot. To make two holes, we also pre-drill a third hole in the middle to align the system. We do not have two points for the other hole to hold it in place, so I attach a clamp to secure it. We use two holes in the front to align the platform and two clamps in the back to lock it in place. On this platform I add the Inca LS positioner. There are two different LS positioners. The left one is an LS positioner that comes delivered with a table saw fence. I used this one before and you can screw this one on an 80mm platform. The right positioner comes delivered with a router fence. And because this one has a higher base, you have to remove it. This is easily done by removing the screws at the underside of the base. For this, you have to remove the fence first. To align the fence, I use the side of the table. So I slide the fence out of my positioner till I can attach some screws. What I did wrong here is not to close the locking handle, so think about that. When the first two screws are in place, I can remove the fence and place the other screws. Because we also aligned the router insert plate with the side of the table, this should be aligned with it as well. If not, that's not that big of a problem because the router bit is round, so it is always aligned. More important is that the T-track we use is perfectly aligned with the fence. So I use the fence to help me to attach the T-track. With the router, I look where I have to put my fence. I use the T-track against the fence, and the reason for this is that the fence is a bit smaller than the table and we have to make a groove over the full length of the table. At the side where we end with the router, I clamp a piece of wood against the workbench. This way we will get a clean cut with no tear outs. After adjusting the right height, we can cut the groove. We need multiple passes for this. Because you can make very small adjustments with the Inca fence, I make a few checks to let the T-track fits perfectly. Make sure the T-track is a little bit lower than the top of the workbench. When we remove the wood piece, we see that it is a very nice and clean cut. Now we have to make the T-track on the right length and send a curve to fit with the workbench. I choose to make my box with bevel cuts for a cleaner look. Of course, the box is basically just 4 pieces of wood, so that is not that hard to do. In the front we have to make the door, and at the back just a hole for a power cord. To make the opening for the door, I first drill some holes on every corner. I marked 4 points at 5 mm from the edge, so using a 10 mm drill bit should end on that line. With a router I cut from hole to hole. I use 5 mm bits for this. With the combination of fence and stop block, it is pretty easy to make this very accurate. The backside only needs a hole for the power cord that we can drill with our drill press. When this is done, we can glue it together. I align the 4 pieces with my dog holes and a straight edge, and with some tape I connect the parts. Flip it around and add some glue. An advantage of this method is that we only have to fold these pieces together. If you made the bevel cuts precise, you do not need clamps for this, and everything will end very nice and square. To screw it to the underside of the workbench, I use pocket holes. Better was to do this before gluing the box together, but luckily it was still possible to do it. At the bottom of the box I add the dust extraction port. I use a 4-inch port, and my adapter had a bit of different form at the inside. Because I wanted maximum airflow, I made the hole in the box the same as the adapter. Luckily I could draw the outline, so I only had to cut it with my jigsaw. After this, I milled a bevel to optimal airflow. Now I could clamp it in place. I made the underside a bit bigger than the box, so after gluing it, I could trim the edge with the router. And after that, I use a bigger chamfer bit to make the bottom looks less massive. At last, I made the sliding door with a rabbit bit. I make a sliding door because when you want to make a groove in the middle of a piece of wood and the wood covers all the holes, your workpiece is sucked to the holes and it will not slide easily. But when you open your sliding door a little bit, it can release the pressure and you can slide the wood easy again. After this, the box is ready to place under the workbench. And don't forget to cover the hole for your power cord, otherwise you lose too much suction. Well, and this is how I made my ultimate workbench. In episode 1, I showed you how I aligned the dog holes from the top and the front panel. And I told you that I did that by aligning the sides of the top and the front. And after watching me back, I don't think that is the best method. So I think it's better to align the actual dog holes. So place 4 bench dogs in the top and the front panel and align them with a straight edge. Then you know that the actual dog holes are aligned. And if that means that the sides are not aligned perfectly, well, we deal with that later. At least we now know that the dog holes on the top and front are perfectly aligned, and that is what we want. Another thing I want to talk about is the material I use for the top and the front. That is what we call in the Netherlands full colored MDF. And where I buy it, that is from a very high quality. So this full colored MDF is denser than normal MDF from a good quality. I put a link in the description where I buy it. It looks like Vogelmat, but based on the price, I don't think it's the same. I paid around 80 euros, including taxes, for a full sheet. I read a lot that outside of the Netherlands, it's not so common. So perhaps we can help each other. If you know where you can buy this full-colored MDF, let me know in your comments. Then I can add that to my description. And if people are interested in this product, it can save them a lot of time. Last thing, I want to put your attention on this side of my website, and that is Get Inspired. People who made a workbench inspired of mine sent me some pictures and I put them there. And they are awesome, and it is very nice to get different ideas. So if you made your workbench, send me your pictures. I would love to put them on my site. Well, this was the second and last part of building my ultimate workbench. Thank you for watching. I hope you found it interesting. Stay safe and well, we see each other next time.